JFT Just Fair and Direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for September the 15th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, head of research here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded higher against most of the other major currencies on Tuesday during the Asian session on Wednesday. It gained against AUD, CAD, GBP, NZD and the euro in that order, while it underperformed versus the yen and the Swiss franc. Now, the relative strength of the US dollar and the safe havens, yen and franc, combined with the weakening of the risk-linked currencies, suggests that financial markets may have traded in a risk-off manner yesterday and today in Asia. Indeed, looking at the performance in the equity world, we see that although EU indices finished mixed, Wall Street finished in the red, with the Dow Jones losing 0.84%. Appetite remained weak during the Asian session today as well. The only exception was South Korea's KOSPI, which gained 0.29%. Now, yesterday, as was widely expected, the highlight on the economic agenda was the US CPIs for August. Although the headline rate ticked down to 5.3% year over year from 5.4%, as was anticipated, the month-over-month rate unexpectedly slid to its lowest in 6 months. What's more, the core CPI slowed to 4% from 4.3% instead of just ticking down to 4.2% as the forecast suggested. Now, initially, the US dollar slid and equities rose as some market participants believed that with the CPIs showing early signs of peaking, the Fed could be more patient and delay its decision to begin tapering its quantitative easing purchases. However, the reaction was short-lived. Soon thereafter, the dollar rebounded to finish higher against most of the other majors, while equities, especially in the US, pulled back. This suggests that the majority of the financial community remained convinced that the Fed will eventually begin trimming its bond purchases this year. And to be honest, their view seems more than reasonable. Despite the slowdowns, both rates, both the CPI rates, remain well above the Fed's objective of 2%, while the PPI rose to a record of 8.3% year over year in August, suggesting that inflationary pressures may have not hit the ceiling yet. So with all that in mind, we would expect the US dollar to continue drifting north for a while more, especially if more Fed officials come out and say that they support tapering to begin this year, while equities may continue correcting lower. However, we would not call for a major trend reversal in equities, as data justifying tapering also point to an improving economic outlook. Thus, at some point, we would expect Wall Street indices to rebound and resume their prevailing uptrends. As for today, during the early European session, we already got the UK CPIs for August. The headline rate surged to 3.2% year over year from 2%, while the core one climbed to 3.1% year over year from 1.9%, both exceeding the 2.9% forecast. Following the better-than-expected employment report yesterday, accelerating inflation and a potential rebound in retail sales on Friday could allow GBP traders to increase their bets over a rate hike by the Bank of England soon and push the pound higher this week, especially against currencies the central bank of which are expected to keep interest rates at low levels for much longer, like the euro and the Aussie. We excluded the yen this time as the Japanese currency could attract flows from the reduced risk appetite we saw yesterday and today, which, as we know, that could continue for a while more. We get more August CPIs later in the day, this time from Canada. The headline rate is forecast to have inched up to 3.9% year over year from 3.7%, while no forecast is available for the core one. The trimmed mean and common rates are forecast to have held steady at 3.1 and 1.7% year over year, respectively. Last week, the Bank of Canada kept interest rates at a record low of 0.25% and maintained its quantitative easing program, as was widely anticipated. In the statement, it was noted that they expect growth to strengthen in the second half, though a fourth coronavirus wave and supply bottlenecks could weigh on the recovery. What's more, they maintained the guidance that the economic slack would be absorbed sometime in the second half of 2022, which means this is when they expect to start raising interest rates. Following the latest disappointing data, especially the economic contraction in the second quarter, many participants may have been expecting the bank to announce a delay in its tapering plans. However, that was not the case. Yes, there was no action at this gathering, but this could be due to the fact that the federal elections are planned in a few days, and perhaps because this was a smaller meeting with no updated economic projections or a press conference. In our view, the door for another tapering in October remained open, and this was confirmed by the Bank of Canada Governor Tiff Macklem, who on Thursday said that he and his colleagues are moving closer to a time when continuing to add stimulus through quantitative easing will not be necessary. Therefore, following Friday's disemployment data, further acceleration in the CPIs could add to the case of an October tapering and could support somewhat the loonie. However, with the risk sentiment subdued lately, we would avoid exploiting any cut gains against the safe havens. We prefer to do so against the Aussie, as the RBA appears to be one of the more dovish major central banks. Now, as for the rest of today's events, during the European session, Eurozone's industrial production is expected to have rebounded 0.6% month over month in July after sliding 0.3% in June. Later in the day, we get the New York Empire State Manufacturing Index for September, which is expected to have slid to 18 from 18.30. With regards to the energy market, we have the Energy Information Administration report on crude oil inventories for last week, which is expected to reveal a 3.544 million barrels decline, following a 1.529 million slide the week before. That said, bearing in mind that yesterday the American Petroleum Institute revealed a 5.437 million barrels fall, we would see the risks surrounding the Energy Information Administration number as tilted to the downside, something that could prove positive for oil prices. As for the speakers, we will get to hear from ECB Executive Board Member Philip Lane. So, that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT. You can find the link in the description below. At this point, I have to let you know that there will be no daily market review video tomorrow and on Friday. So goodbye, have a great day and great rest of the week, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next week.
JFT, just fair and direct.